Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10.03 p.m. Central Time on the 29th of November, 2018. It is Thursday night here in the USA, going into Friday already internationally, guys. And let me welcome you in to where we normally talk about seismic events, but I have, of course, not been around most of this week, suffering from a major flu. And still dealing with that, actually. It's kind of getting a long endurance, but I'm doing much better. Thanks for all the well wishes, emails, and letters now people have sent. It's been that long that I've actually received mail from people wishing me well. So thank you, guys. I appreciate it. And I am on the upside of this, but still, definitely, you could probably still hear it in my head. But okay, we're not here to talk about me. We're here to talk about earthquakes. And we're using a three-dimensional representation of the planet, of course. And we're using the USGS combined with the EMSC to give us a good picture of what's happened over the past couple days. 48 hours worth of earthquakes is what we're looking at right now. And the most recent earthquakes are colored in white. The older earthquakes from a day and a half, almost 2 days ago, marked in a pink and red. Okay, so the only other thing you might not understand if you're new, the height of the earthquakes off the planet equals the depth into the Earth. So we're looking at deeper earthquakes, the higher they are raised off the planet. Okay, so we have deep earthquakes, for instance, that happened a few days back here on our letter D. Our letter D, and we have several of them here in the West Pacific, across the West Pacific, where you see our letter D's, that's where we expect new deep earthquakes to occur. And we weren't let down. We got a new deep 4.3 coming in exactly at 200 kilometers deep. And this struck today. We'll start with this earthquake. Let's go over to our depth to magnitude conversion chart. Okay, so depth to magnitude conversion, pretty obvious. If you look at the screen here, look at about 200, which is right on the left-hand side of the chart. And we need to add on 0.4 magnitude to this deep quake. And that's just where we start out. Okay, so let me turn on a display capture. And here we would add on 0.4 magnitude to this, and that would take us up to 4.7, striking downstream. So we'd be looking at a 4.7 popping up in Iran in the next several days. Just as an example of what a deep earthquake, what we normally look for. Now, speaking of what we normally look for with deep earthquakes, we go back to the 18th, 11 days ago. There was a deep earthquake here in the 500 kilometer depth range, and it came in at 6.7 magnitude, which led us to issue a warning for Indonesia to be on watch for up to 7.8. That did not hit. We went all week without any significant activity at all in Indonesia. Now look what happened today. Obviously, the only earthquakes we're talking about any activity today is here in the West Pacific in Indonesia, starting with a 5.8, or I should say starting with a 5.0 and 5.8 side by side. And you see how the rings overlap? They're like perfectly spaced almost, and it goes over to the east as well, with our fulcrum point being the middle point here at Java, Indonesia. This is Java, and this is Sumatra. Well, right next to Sumatra, here, a 5.8 near 6.0 earthquake. And while this is a significant size event, USGS has it at 5.7. So if you go check USGS, let's go actually over and look at their magnitude list. They're not telling us how they're coming to their 5.7, but body magnitude here shows six, series of sixes. I'm not going to read them all to you. We can scroll down the list and you can see there's even sevens on the list. We would throw out the high end and throw out the low end. And if we throw out the high end and throw out the low end, it still leaves us with a range of upper 5 to 6.0. I mean, it went up as high as 7.6, I think is the highest. But still, multiple sevens on the list. Upper sixes, we'll put it at a mid-range six as what the potential high end could have been. But they went with 5.7, 5.8, whatever it is next to Mount Cinnabung, which stopped erupting back on June 20th. But while Mount Cinnabung stopped erupting and it used to erupt almost weekly, we saw an increase here at Krakatau, and then back over to the east, we also saw an increase at Dukono, Kerangeting, and Mount Ebu over the past several days. So there were three simultaneously erupting volcanoes here, and one right at the middle point where the two earthquake rings overlap, and that again is Mount Krakatau. Let's go check really quick and see what's on the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. Kuchina Arabajima and Suwanee-Zajima, side by side, as well as Mount Mayon, just south in Philippines. Fuego all the way across the Pacific in Guatemala, Reventador also as well. Turrialba as well, going back to Manam, Kuchina Arabajima, Dukono. Let's just scroll down and see if there's any others on the list for today. Sakurajima in South Japan, Sanjay in Ecuador again. These are all our usual suspects. Any others? Okay, well, I mean, the list just kind of keeps going on and on and on. Yesterday, we had Kerangeting and Ebu, as well as Santa Guido in Guatemala late last night. Krakatau not on the list today. Okay, well, we have earthquakes on both sides. Up to the north, nothing in Japan. A whole day, no earthquakes from North Philippines, where Mount Mayon is erupting, going all the way across Japan, where we have three eruptions, Kuchina Arabajima, Suwanee-Zajima, and Sakurajima, all three right here. And then we go all the way across, and we get to Alaska, where Veniaminoff was erupting last night. Okay, so no earthquake activity, but volcanic increase in the past couple days. So lack of earthquakes, increase in volcanoes. It can go back and forth. We can see an increase, for instance, in earthquakes after the volcanoes stop erupting, but that gets into a long story of why and plate deformation, and people, again, don't want to see the connection between the volcanoes and the earthquakes. It's very strange. But anyway, we will see, next to where the volcanoes are erupting, we will see that then translate into seismic activity. Within days, it doesn't take very long. Over far past this deep earthquake that we talked about at the start of the broadcast, all the way over to Europe we go, and here in Turkey, right next to Istanbul, new 4.2, and over to the west, new 4.6, coming in right on the shores of Greece. Multiple twos going across Italy on the plate boundary. And let's just go back to the earthquake that struck last night, 3.3 up in Poland, as well as a 3 down in Spain, right at the Gibraltar Strait. Basically the same sized earthquakes on both sides of the plate. Italy still has been somewhat spared, and I knock on wood, because we do not, again, haven't have any large earthquakes to report out of Italy in a fair long time. I think the highest we went so far was 4.2, and that was up near Florence. Okay, so that's our update for the West Pacific. Pretty short, right? I mean, not much activity. For my Aussie viewers, an additional 2. Well, that's expected when you get deep earthquakes all the way up to your north. Okay, hold on one second. Let me get a sip of my drink. Uno momento. And let me clear my throat. we're live. All right, okay. All the way over here across, going over to South America, let's quickly wrap this up with the small earthquakes that struck today. I mean, look, we're only dealing with a 5 coming across from yesterday. Today, equal spread of 4s, 4.4 to the south, or I should say right at the center of South America, and then a 4 right at the center point of Peru, and a 4.6 up to the north on our transfer zone. You see our small little arrow there? Okay, well, those arrows point over to the east, which means we're going to see a new incoming round of activity striking over in the Eastern Caribbean in the next couple days. It'll be the combined total of the 4.5 and 4.6, could go up to 4.7, 4.8 going over to the east, okay? Nothing to report to you across Central America, seismically speaking. Well, we have volcanoes Fuego and Santa Guido, as well as Turrialba, Sanjay and Reventador, Sabancaya, and Nevados de Chilean, all going. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 simultaneous erupting volcanoes with no earthquakes. Well, that's going to be flipped around here in the next couple days. There's no doubt about that. Okay, so in the next couple days, as the volcanoes erupt, watch for that to give way for new activity to pop up next to the volcanoes going up to the near 5 range, as I've told you before, many times in the past. When the volcanoes erupt, after they stop erupting, then new earthquakes strike next to the volcanoes on the nearest plate boundary. Okay, and now let's get out here to Hawaii. New activity coming in where? Back at Kilauea, finally. And we need to turn on our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed. And look at all the smaller earthquakes. Here we go. Alright, there we are. So what you'll see here is a cluster of earthquakes along the coast, back to Kilauea itself, and then pretty much I would say one of the larger earthquakes of the day, striking on the western northwest flank of Mauna Loa. And let's go put the coordinates in. Come along with me. Let's go look it up together. Ah, yes. Man, I still feel funky, guys. I can still feel it in me. It's just one of these long-running flus, man. Crazy. Makes you feel like an alien, like you're floating on air or something. You know what? Some troll's going to take that out of context. They're going to take me just saying that part, right? Okay, yeah. No, I'm talking about having the flu, guys. Come on. Okay, anyways, here we are. We're looking at Hawaii, and we're going on the back side all the way over here to Mauna Loa's other side. Now, other side of what? Kilauea's all the way over here. So Kilauea collapsed, and I'm not going to be talking about it at length tonight. You can go back and watch one of my other video updates on this. But all I've got to say, largest earthquake of the day striking not at Kilauea, striking at the other volcanoes again. And then we go along the coast, and the coast tied to the breakout points, and we're really right along the coast. It shows, some of these show out to sea, but really they're like right along the shore. These are past fissure points for Mauna Loa and Kilauea at some extent, but it's down along the coast. So there's shifting that's happening around Kilauea as it's reinflating. There's no doubt about it. It is reinflating. I don't even bother even going over to the Hawaii Volcano Observatory page anymore. It was just such a scientific disgrace what they were doing over the past several months. Let's go see what's happening on the multimedia page. Now, no disrespect to the average Joe who's working out there in the field, likely doing all the science in the world. I'm talking about the public relations portion of this. People get this confused. I'm not going out. I don't even know who the people are. Come on. So I'm just talking about when they're waiting a month. Look, 20 days. So, I mean, that's a long time to go without releasing any pictures, information at all. And the pictures that are released is this. Well, it's good to know you've got a drone. I'm glad you're taking pictures of the drone. It would help if you were taking pictures of the inside of the freaking crater. Okay? I'm not trying to be sarcastic, but if we were going to get a picture posted on here after a month without anything, what are you giving us? You give us this? Come on. Guys, I don't know what's up. If I did this, if even on YouTube I did this, like I go a month, imagine this. I cut out from, I've been sick for a few days, right? So, you know, but imagine I cut out for 20 days. Don't post a thing. No pictures, nothing. Keep posting the same repeat, cut and paste on my blog every day for a month. And then finally I show back up and there's a picture of the Duchess or somebody you might think might be. She's standing there in a dutchsinse shirt with her back turned to you with her picture, and we're out there somewhere, you think it's Hawaii, me probably. And then I got a picture of my drone, and I take a picture of my drone, and I go, here you go, guys. And you're like, Dutch, wouldn't it be great if you just like actually posted the drone itself? wouldn't it be, you know, you can live stream your drone, Dutch? You're like, that's the kind of stuff people would say to me. Okay, I'm not trying to lecture or go off too hard. I'm just speaking common sense here. Let's go over to the United States, where we need to talk about something. A 4.5 or 4.2 or two separate earthquakes or a single earthquake recorded two different times by two different agencies, but a mid-range 4 coming in here in BC, British Columbia, Canada. But guys, there's something else we need to go look up. This can't be a coincidence at all. This earthquake, how long has it been since we've seen any earthquakes reported out of central western Canada? Months? Has to be months, right? Okay, well here we are. Let's go look something else up. Let's go over to the hotspot feed. I'm gonna go look at the GOES 16, the new feed that we can look at to see hotspots in areas from fires and other geothermal hotspot related areas. And we'll turn on natural color fire. Okay, and we're going to go to regional subsectors. Let's see if it'll load. There we go. Regional subsectors, natural color fire. And if you want to use this, guys, if by the way, if you're on here, this is Weather College of DuPage, EDU. And we're going to click on Southern Canada first. And let's look at the last 96 images. And you can either hit play or you can use your mouse to drag it over and manually scroll through the frames. We're going to bring it in right here at sunset and beyond. Okay. There we go. Wait a second. Wait just one second. Okay, I don't know if this is going to show. I'll have to go in at a localized sector. I'll bring it in from Idaho first. You're going to have to look really close. This might not show if you're on a tablet or a small phone. But starting up here in Idaho, we've got a series of hotspots that are showing up here in South Canada, and they go across Montana down here to the south. And I'll bring it back out to a subsector view. One time here, and we'll go down into Montana. Maybe it'll show it this way a little better. So we'll go in at sunset and beyond. It just got done snowing. So snowing and ice up here. Yeah, you can see we've got here, we've got here, we've got across North Idaho. Now, we were looking at this earlier, myself and several other researchers, and they the feed cut off. Believe it or not, when we were looking at it, you could say it was just a coincidence that the feed cut off. But when feeds start cutting off, when many people are starting to look at something and it comes back and the images are dimmer or more dim, but even then, even with the dimming that they added or whatever happened when this feed cut off, you can still see several of them. So there and up in Canada, we have confirmed several hotspots that are showing up again. And it's, guys, I don't know what to say. It's, here, let me go back out and show you Canada again. Here's today and going into this evening. Here, all the way across here. Do you see these? These are not wildfires. It just got done snowing, ice. Here. This is Canada now. So it's not just down in Idaho, and it's not just down in Montana. It's also up here, right in central BC. So that's why I wanted to show you this, because this is British Columbia, Canada, if I could even say it. And we're going to go look this location up. This is Haida Gwaii, I believe, right there. So let's open up Google Earth and jump over here. Let me turn off my wells. That'll save us some time. Okay, yep. Here's the Hecate Strait. Here's, I think I'm saying that right, Haida Gwaii. And then over to the east, all the way across here. Let's just make sure that it matches. So here's the southern tip of Haida Gwaii, and we go due east. And that's where our hotspots are. One, two, three of them. Right across here, or maybe four. Why does that matter? Look, Haida Gwaii, go right across here. What's one, two, three, four? Four separate volcanic fields. Sata, Itcha, Baldface Mountain, and Nazco. And each one has its own Smithsonian place mark. If you want to pause and read on each one, they haven't erupted in a long time. They are hotspots geothermal, and they're lighting up. These are lighting up almost as bright as the wildfires were in California. So we've got ourselves something going on here, because look what else happened. Here is Haida Gwaii. Here, go due east. Here's our hotspot locations. And then, well, just north, a 4.5 striking out here. Now, I would like to pull the coordinates and go see what's at the location itself for this 4 out in BC. Got a good sneaking suspicion there's something else out here, guys. What do you see? See all these little pads that are out here? Every one of these little cutout pads is not a forestry clear cut, although they probably did take and use the trees. See these pipelines? Pipelines go to drill points. Drill points, they're doing fracking, oil, and gas pumping at this location. And it's huge. It goes on just for miles. Okay. So there you go. Oil pumping operation on the edge of the craton, north of a hotspot. I mean, are we going to pay attention to the hotspots? I think we should. If we look down south, I checked today, nothing pretty much south of Washington. So it's all centered right here in Montana, which is the north side of Yellowstone's magma chamber. And it goes back up across the edge of the craton. There's just no doubt about it. So what are the hotspots? Well, they're too big to be man-made. They're not wildfires, and they're showing up next to volcanic locations. That's what the hotspots are. So, there we go. 24 hours worth of earthquakes. Take a look at it. Look at our spread going into Canada. Now, these are on the 4 level, but we go down to 2s and 1s, and we get into California and the West Coast. Let's go look these up, starting up here in the Northwest. Now, I could save us some time and just name off each location, but a picture speaks a thousand words. Let's put the coordinates in. Go take a look. Tanner, Washington. We don't normally have to look this location up. Now, it's not really at any specific location. It's next to a spot. So here we are. There we go. We're next to 4 or 5 distinct volcanoes, which are old in their own right. Vesper, Gothic, North Crested Butte, Silvertip, and Monte Cristo Peak. Now, really, I would say they should have marks on these from the Smithsonian. The Smithsonian only has the Glacier Peak marked. Okay, well, we're right south. And what is this? Mount Daniel. Now, it could very well be that Chimney Rock, Mount Daniel, could very well be that these are ancient volcanoes in their own right. Surprised there's no place marks around there. But anyway, we are just south. We always look within 40 miles. Definitely close enough to be related to the cluster of large volcanoes to the north. So that one, the more kind of iffy earthquake. We should go check and see if there's a USGS marked fault at the location. That might help. Well, we're right next to the Seattle Fault. Okay, the Seattle Fault dead ends at the foothills here. Could very well be that it carries on even further. They don't have them all marked, that's for sure. Look. They only have a very small portion of all the faults mapped, guys. They would, to their defense, they would need billions of dollars and probably 50 years to do it. But they probably could map all the faults if they had the funding and the time. Okay, let's go down to the south and see what's at Eatonville, Washington. Now, I think longtime viewers know what's right next here. So, let's go look it up. Here it is, Mount Rainier. We're right on the flanks of it, though we're not on the crater like we were a couple days back at the start of this week. We were down here below the crater. Now we're on the flanks of the volcano. And I've told you guys before, it's like a tent So the center rises first and then the outside edges start to rise. Same thing with this. Center rose first, outside edges begin to rise. And it's going to continue to do that. A new 1.7 striking in the Puget Sound on the Seattle Fault. And we need to go check the real-time tremor map from the University of Washington. Let's go see what they're doing. And Pacific Northwest Seismic Network. It's trying to be nice. Much love to all the people, even to the people who gave me a hard time. Hey, I understand, skeptical of people online. Big thumbs up to being skeptical of people online. I never faked anything, never did anything wrong. I was trying to just show you guys what I was thinking was going on. You all freaked out. Water under the bridge. Do some science. Get on board. Word up. Now let's go on. Here we go. 48 hours. What's going on? Look at all the tremors. Okay, this isn't very much. But it is an increase from where we were a few days back, which was next to nothing. There were three. So this is an increase from three. But it's still very small. All the little red dots are, they're small vibrations in the plate. They're not actual earthquakes, not actual fractures in the plate. But if you start seeing a cluster of these, where they get up into the hundreds of small vibrations, then it can become a slow slip, quote-unquote, event. And you'll see it start to move, usually from north to south, sometimes from south to north. And as it moves, that's actually the plate shifting and vibrating as it's moving. But it usually happens in big clusters when the plate's in big-time motion. Well, right now it's just small. Just little small pockets. And it'll pop off like this, like popcorn, popping off back and forth as new forces introduced on the plate, small stresses, and it starts out to sea. So the push actually comes from out to sea, out in the Juan de Fuca, and it actually comes from up in Alaska, and actually we need to look at the earthquakes to see that. Coming out of Alaska and going down to the United States, look which way our arrows point. So it's a force flow across a region. And we get the earthquakes breaking out in lines reflecting that flow. So across the edge of the interior portion of the craton, for instance, going right by where our hot spots are, being detected in Montana now. Again, guys, hot spots in Montana and a few up in Canada going down through Idaho. So with the new hot spots going along the edge of the craton, take a look at the craton edge. Take a look at where our earthquakes are residing. So we have an earthquake striking right along the edge of the craton, going down to the east by southeast towards Yellowstone. And we can trace it all the way back up to the west-northwest, and it goes back up to our four that we were just talking about other at our other hotspot location here next to Canada, or in Canada next to BC. So that's all taking place going down the edge of the plate. Let's go here into the Midwest. This is a place called Bull Shoals Lake. Now, I call this BS Lake because this is what they blamed. They blamed this lake for the earthquakes that started to strike here. And I said, oh, man, they're trying to say the water weight of the lake was triggering a nearby fault. And, you know, I mean, in a perfect world, yeah, maybe that could be a cause, might be a cause, but this is my home state here in Missouri, and I'm about 3.5 hours north here, okay, west to St. Louis, but need I remind everybody what's right down, right next to this spot, and this where I have all these place marks where they say Frackwell, this doesn't just stop where my place marks are, they've carried on in production. So this imagery date, 2014, So, I mean, they have really expanded out from here, again, since 2014 in several other counties. And I don't have them all marked, but we always look within 6 to 10 miles. So I would look somewhere in these two counties for new drill points. But we're already next to Zinc and Lead Hill. The mining down here is phenomenal, the amount of mining that they've done. So to blame it on Bull Shoals Lake is to me a load of BS, and since Missouri is the show me state, I want to see that fault zone that's moving here. Let's see some new images of that fault, and while you're at it, let's go find out if there's any new drill points that are around this location. Let's get that imagery updated, because people's lives depend on this, knowing whether or not there's drill points next to you. Why does your life depend on that? Because 5.0 activity is enough to knock down a chimney, take down facades off houses. We saw a 4.2 in Oklahoma at the pumping operations here, take chimneys into people's houses, cause major injuries. Serious. People got injured. And that was just with the 4 and 5.0 activity. There is the potential for larger activity, but it takes a big push coming in from the northwest. Speaking of that, that big 6.8 that was put in here several weeks ago, it was absorbed by the plate. There's no doubt about that. The fires broke out, the swarms broke out, the fours broke out. That's it, though. So California may have absorbed the force, but it translated into magmatic movement, maybe? Still waiting to find that out. May just be taking longer than expected. Now let's go here. Look at our spread of earthquakes going from California all the way over into Utah. Okay, I mean, this is just a phenomenal spread, and you should be able to see it. It's like a diagonal connecting line from Northern California across over to Utah. So where should we start? Should we start in California? The force normally starts all the way to the west and pushes to the east. The oldest earthquake here, though, is the 2 all the way to the east. So let's go over to the east, start there, work our way over to the west coast, and then down the coast, down to Southern California. So slow slip on the west coast has basically puttered out. So as the slow slip basically stops, what else is going on? Well, let me make sure my wells are turned off. Those slows everything down. Here we are. What are we right next to? We're right next to Cinder Crater and Mineral Mountains Cove Fort. Now, I haven't had to look this one up in a long time. Pleistocene Mineral Mountains Cove Fort volcanic field contains silicic lavic domes. Okay, never heard of this place before, but it's on the edge of Black Rock Desert, which we've had to look up many times before, but we've looked it up directly when we get earthquakes striking right next to this ancient lava flow in its own right. And Black Rock Desert, I think I have some samples a viewer sent me from Black Rock Desert. So amazing, right? We're right next to it, though, and I'll say it's related to the volcano right next to it. So we have a little outbreak going on over there to the east, far east, next to a volcano in Utah. Let's go to this 1.3. An explosion, Ely, Nevada. We don't need to look up any explosions, do we? Hold on, let's make sure it's at the surface. Okay, it is. Surface explosion, we pass those up, usually, unless they're in Oregon. Let's go down to the south. Alamo, Nevada. Ah, yes, Alamo. We had to look this location up for many weeks on end last year when swarms broke out at Alamo, Nevada, and led us to do a scouring of the area only to find out that there's a giant fault that runs through here, and the way you identify the fault is to look into the middle of the valley. Okay, well, if you go into the middle of the valley, you follow it up to the north, it carries on and then it goes right into the mountains, and it just keeps going and going and going. So that's our connecting fault. And we're right along it. You can also follow it down to the south. Goes right into Vegas. Goes around Vegas or through Vegas, down through Enterprise, and picks up with the Sloan Volcanic Field, which is down here. It's not even marked. I think they don't have it marked as a volcanic field because, I mean, if you're right on the south side of Vegas, would you buy a house there? I don't know. Maybe you would. I would. I would just make my house out of lava rock, igneous rock, huge. So in case something ever flows through, it's just going to go around the house. Yeah, it's the kind of house I'd live in. I guess it'd be more like the Mount Doom and, the Tower of Sauron. The Tower of Dutch. Yeah, only instead of the eye on top, we'll put a big GoPro camera. How about that? It's about the same thing. Okay, you know what? Do we even need to go any further? We can go throughout California. What I'm getting ready to tell you is everything that we just looked up here in Nevada could be applied to each one of our California locations, starting to the north, going up here to Northern California right here at the tip of the valley, then going down along the border. Every single one of these locations that I'm getting ready to show you is a volcano. And it's right at a volcano. It's not like we have to go venture very far to go find one. So we can start here. This is Geysers, California. Or, according to the Europeans, just Northern California. Let's get the USGS coordinates. There we go. Geysers. Show it all the time. Show it every night. I do an update. And it's Clear Lake Volcano or Clear Lake Volcanic Field. Here it is. Geyser Peak. And there are our geothermal turbines yet once again. And next to it, Mount Conocti and the others. So it's a Mother Nature punch point that's already weak. Humans have drilled into it, and it's now like a pressure gauge. The more this goes up, the more activity you see at geysers, the more force that's flowing into California. When geyser starts to go quiet and gets down next to nothing, you look for something to strike off the coast or near to the coast to give it a new kick in, and then a new spread begins and geyser starts to swarm again. Let's go up to the north, so we're leaving this volcano here, and let's go up to the north tip of Sacramento Valley, where there's another volcano, a series of volcanoes, right on the tip of the valley. So we're going from one volcano to another, directly. So here we are, next to Inskip and Black Butte Cone. So Inskip is here. Go ahead and pause it, read it. It's very short. Inskip Hill and nearby pyroclastic cones were thought to be of Holocene age, but later mapping indicates a late Pleistocene age. Miller 89. Must have been a good year for Miller. There we go. Black Butte right next to it. Now, I got to remind everybody, about 2.5-3 weeks ago, series of earthquakes started here around these series of volcanoes, Inskip and Black Butte. That was the same time the USGS got infected with porn from their Russian porn bot thing that happened. And we were joking around about Black Butte and them looking it up and all that, right? Okay, that all happened just a couple of weeks back. Then a series of earthquakes broke out just down to the south, going from the Butte's Butte to Sugarloaf, back down to Sugarloaf South and Steamboat Springs. And we talked about this oval shape, and I just supposed out loud that it could be a supervolcano. Couldn't prove it, just saying it could be. And we talked about the potential of volcanoes making up the whole ring. Then, all that got sidetracked with the new fires that broke out at Paradise on the backside of the oval. So as the earthquakes were striking here and here, then we got the fires, which broke out here. Same thing happened down to the south. We had earthquakes striking, and that's happening again today. So let's go prove this to you. We go from, again, let's recap, from geysers up to Inskip and Black Butte, and then we jump over to the east. This is taking us over next to Pyramid Lake, which is another volcanic field with a place called the Needles that are going down into the lake itself. And it's a geothermal field with, I'll show it to you here, old pillow lava formations, and there's fumaroles here, and it's like a geyser field that's on the edge of Pyramid Lake. So there, that's again called the Needles. We go further down to the south and we're connected with small microquakes, 0.3 and 0.9. Let's put the 0.3 in first. This is going to take us in next to the lava beds on the side of Pyramid Lake. And the old photos are gone, unfortunately, but you still might be able to see these. Here we go. Sugarloaf Peak is a good example here. So they're all over the place, and that's just one. It's my supposition that this whole thing is one ancient supervolcano on North Reno. Let's go down to the south of Lake Tahoe. South of Lake Tahoe we go. Now this is going to take us south of Steamboat Springs. But I always look within 40 miles. We'll show you what's within 40 miles. Just to the south. There we go. So if we go in either direction, one direction goes to Steamboat Springs, other direction goes down to Mono Lake. So I would say we're more preferencing near Steamboat Springs. Now some people have ventured out that they think Lake Tahoe is a volcano. I don't think so. At least there's no real evidence to show that it is. Now it could be part of a deformation that happened when this supervolcano to the north that is not yet identified, except maybe by me, and down here to the south, this supervolcano that has been identified, Long Valley caldera, now elevated to supervolcanic status. Well, look where our earthquakes are striking to the south. Let's turn down the rings. Okay, so you'll see some on the Nevada side of the border, and some on the California side of the border, and then the largest of the bunch right at the border itself. So let's pull those coordinates first for the largest quake, then just branch out on either side of the border and show you what's there. Again, this is for new people. All the regular viewers already know what's right here. See this? This is a Mono Lake. So first of all, this is where the earthquake is. This is the California-Nevada border right here. And this is Mono Lake with Pahoa Island rising out of the center of the supposed volcanic field. I'll call it a smaller supervolcano, yet unidentified. Or it's part of the same, and it's just much bigger. But we go across the border over to the east, and we go right through Mud Springs Volcanic Butte, and we dead-end into the Laccolith again. Now these are a series of bulges in the plate. Most have not erupted, a few have ruptured and released some of their magmatic contents, and you can see the coloration on that, indicating which ones rose and didn't rupture and which ones did. A laccolith is a bulge in the plate from intruding magma down below that doesn't normally come up and erupt. So why would that happen? Well, look at the shape of it. It's a huge ring of them, and it's about the size of Mono Lake or Long Valley supervolcano. Now we jump down to the south. We just jumped over here. That's Black Dyke Laccolith here, all the way around that ring of volcanoes that I just showed you. And then we jump back down here to the border. Okay, what's down here at the 0.5? Tom's Place. Now it's just a hop, skip, and a jump away, so it's pretty easy to find. There it is. So we're just right next to Mammoth Mountain. Here's Mammoth Mountain. It's the ski resort town with the volcano on it, or where they all ski on the volcano. Wonderful. And why, again, it is. It's absolutely beautiful. It's just a volcano, that's all, and the top of the mountain fractured off this past year. There's been an ongoing earthquake swarm there. They said that the top of the mountain fractured off due to snow. But the ongoing earthquake swarm there is just one part of this. There's also a possible reason that the earthquakes keep coming back to this point. I don't know when they put these in, but these are geothermal turbines. Well, they obviously didn't know at the time when they put them in, because they just found out 2 months ago that this is a supervolcano with 240 cubic miles of melt down below. So we need to go down to the south, where we do have a distinct cluster which has developed. It's our largest swarm of the day so far, and it's broken out recently here, I'd say in the last 4 or 5 hours, here in Southern California, down next to Little Lake California. Sounds very quaint. It's out in the middle of the desert. Let me show you what's at the location. Okay, see these? These are small little lakes, of course. No, this is not even the location. This is the location they triangulate from, by the way. Look, 12 kilometers northeast of Little Lake, California. I'll show you where Little Lake is. These are not little lakes. Well, I mean, yeah, they are little lakes, but this is a geothermal pumping operation at a place called Devil's Kitchen. Devil's Kitchen is in the middle of Kozo Volcanic Field, which itself is right next to Volcano Peak and all its impressive lava flows and multiple buttes. So there's many breakpoints there and 4 or 5 cones and scorias and it goes on and on and on. Look at that. So this is the highway, and I've shown this many times. We've shown this so many times. You can even do a street level on this to drive right through the side of the volcano itself. Here. There. So you can see it. It's like, you could just get off on the side of the highway. Don't do that. But yeah, I guess you could. And run up the center of the volcano. Don't be crazy. Don't do that. It's Death Valley out here anyways. You'll get sunburned or something. But you look out across the valley, right? They wouldn't scrape this away. When you're driving along, you might not even think that this is a volcano. But it is. And there we go. So we have a big swarm breaking out at the geothermal pumping operation. So there's only one earthquake connecting between those that I didn't look up yet, and that's this little microquake here. Well, I can just pull the coordinates and show it to you. 41 kilometers east-southeast of Big Pine, California. There is something there, too. There's something at each one of even these little microquake locations. It's not just happening randomly. There's a reason. So look, what are we next to? See these? These are the Yubihibi craters here. And over to the west is the Big Pine volcanic field. Well, sandwiched between the Yubihibi craters and the Big Pine volcanic field, we'll call it the dutchsinse volcanic field. They don't have a name for it. I'm just joking around here. But you can see it. It's made up of a series of old cones that are so weathered down over time that they're almost hard to see. You have to look from a very high angle, but you'll see that they're spaced out here, 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 here. And you can make out the sill. You can still make out the sills on these. So it's not like I'm saying anything crazy. This is just not marked. Or this is considered technically part of the Yubihibi craters. But it looks like a separate volcanic field. I mean, that's what it is. It doesn't just look like it. That's what it is. And it goes over to the west, where these, this here, see this here? Ah, perfect. You can still see it. You can still see the breaking black and reddish colored basalts. But on this side and this side, there's two of them here and then more of them here, correct? Now compare that over to Volcano Peak. Let's do that. I love doing this so people can see. Go all the way back down here to Volcano Peak. Here's Volcano Peak. And look, what do we have? On the side of Volcano Peak, we have the same kind of formations. One, two, covered with the top, another one on the side, and the old lava flow covered in sand. So it's definitely an ancient volcano, no doubt about it. Amazing, right? I mean, so I've just proved to you, now it's not even up for debate. Starting up here in Washington, where we finally have some earthquakes reported, by the way. Oh, by the way. Another day where there are no earthquakes of any size reported out of Oregon. Let's go over to the USGS site and just verify. Let's go do this. Do it. Just do it. Okay, there we go. One day, all magnitudes US. And another day, Oregon, no quakes. So we're keeping track on a daily basis. And no earthquakes again reported. Somebody's wrong somewhere, and we're just pointing out that the statement from the USGS is not matching reality. And every day that goes by without an answer is another day with egg on their face. Let's carry on. Going down towards Southern California. Well, let's recap. Volcano up here to the north. Geysers. Volcano here. Inskip and Black Butte Cone. Needles, volcanic field, and geothermal up here at North Pyramid Lake. Going down past, we go down into South Reno or south of Lake Tahoe. And I'm saying that's related to the giant oval shape there. That's somewhat up for debate. It's a 0.3. Going further down to the south, all those volcanoes I just got done showing you, including the laccoliths around Black Dyke Laccolith, and then down across the border at Mono Lake, and then across further down into Mammoth Mountain. Our biggest stack happening here at Kozo Volcanic Field. So there's only a few more over to the east that I would even need to show you. This one, of course, we already talked about. Well, what about these? These are nuclear test sites out here in Nevada. I'll just pull one of the coordinates up for you guys, and we'll show it to you. Nuke test sites. Here we go. Now, how do we know they're nuke test sites? Well, we can turn on the Google Earth community, which has done a good job of identifying and pulling the information on each nuke test. So we'll zoom in and just pull a random one here, whichever one we zoom in on first. U.S. nuke Operation Praetorian Molbo. February 12th, 1982, 80 kilotons. Okay. U.S. nuke Operation Musketeer Belmont, 16th of October, 1986, 140 kilotons. And there's bigger detonations, which they've done here, I think. U.S. nuke Operation Taibo, May 14th, 1975, 1,000 kilotons. That would be a megaton. A 1 megaton underground blast. So those are our nuke test sites. That's the earthquake in the middle, to the north, and to the south. Down to the south puts us right next to Doomtown. So here's our earthquake location. And if we go just down to the south, we get down here in the south tip of this valley. And this valley contains more craters. Every crater is a different, separate nuke test, usually smaller in the 10 to 20 to 100 kiloton range. This one, U.S. nuke Operation Mesita, May 9th, 1973, 20 kilotons. But the other earthquake striking just down here, next to Doomtown, where the above-ground nuke test happened. Wonderful. As we go over the only earthquake striking directly at faults in California so far, along the coast, 2.4, 2.3, 1.7 on the creeping section of the San Andreas, and then further to the south, still on the creeping section, ones. And that follows yesterday's fours that broke out. Now don't forget, it was two different fours. They downgraded to 3.9. Okay. Hey, new earthquake just struck, or series of earthquakes, small, just struck up here at Geysers, California. So let's get down into Southern California, into the LA Basin. Pull the coordinates here. San Pedro. Now, we also dealt with a 3.9, 4.0 earthquake early this morning. That was AM. That was at like 5 AM this morning. Out here on the West Coast, you guys got a 4.0 earthquake. And we'll talk about that in a second. But look where our LA Basin quake is coming in next to. I'll be darned. Coming in next to our offshore drilling platforms. No doubt about it. We're pretty close to them. So definitely right next to the pumping operations. We were up here right next to these at the Baldwin Hills pumping operations. We've shifted to the south. Just a little bit. Most people wouldn't even think about the pumping operations out here. They're definitely close enough. Let's just do a line measurement to find out how far. 8.8 miles. We always look within 6 to 10 miles. Definitely close enough. There may also be other drill points that are along the coast. Small wells and so forth placed out over here. Very well could be. I do not have a well place mark map for California at all, so we have to find them point by point. When we find them, we mark them. Getting back to them is usually pretty hard if you don't. As we go back down to the south by southeast, you're going to see another diagonal line of quakes. How many times am I going to say that tonight? Diagonal line of quakes going from northwest to southeast across Montana. Diagonal line of tremors going down the coast from Washington into Oregon and California. And then another diagonal line of quakes along California-Nevada's border, all at the volcanoes. And the final diagonal line of quakes along the San Andreas itself, going all the way from Geysers down through the creeping section of the San Andreas and ending up down here where we're getting ready to go look up the largest earthquake of the day, which is a 4.0. Oh, 3.9, I mean. It came in at 4.1. Yeah, they brought it in at 3.9. It's a little custom with the USGS. Bring it down to a 0.9. Yeah, that's just the way they do it. You know what? I think it's a way to pad the numbers, to keep things low. So if people look in the future, how many 4.0 or greater earthquakes struck Southern California in late November 2018? None will show up. You search 4.0 and greater. But if you search 3.9, you'll get the earthquake that hit, right? So it's a way to keep it low. People think that nothing hit. It's a way to obfuscate, maybe? That's what I think. I can't prove that. It's just, we've seen it enough to start to raise our eyebrows. So here's our 3.9. which the list shows nothing but fours on the list, striking right next to our volcano. That's right, Salton Butte's volcano, and guess what's at this volcano? They've drilled into it to get steam to turn turbines, and they're placed all throughout here. And the pipelines spread out several miles. You can follow them down the roads and out to the drill points that are spaced out. And it doesn't just stop there. It goes right down here to Imperial, where there's more. And it keeps going down to El Centro, down here. And right past the border, even. And it goes over into Mexico at Cerro Prieto, which is another volcano like Salton Sea. And next to it, geothermal. So our 3.9, 4.0 earthquake striking on the San Jacinto Fault, not on the San Andreas, the Ocotillo or Ocohilo wells that NASA is now studying. I've been trying to pronounce it for 2 years. Now NASA's studying it. Well, maybe they can also provide a pronunciation key for me to follow, because here we are, and they're finally studying this spot. Why are they studying it? This whole line here, this line of red lines that are, actually, it's a line made up of lines. Okay, these are all separate points on the same fault. The San Jacinto connects from the San Andreas down to the Imperial. But really, the San Andreas is the Imperial. It's the plate boundary. So it connects from point to point. Think of this like your knee bending, and this is the backside of your knee, the part that bends in. Okay, so this would be the spot that's getting pushed in, and this would be the spot that flexes in or out. And here we are, and this spot has been receiving a bunch of pressure, a bunch of force coming in on the backside of it. And as it's been receiving this coming in, it's been releasing over and over again with, well, swarms of earthquakes. Now it'll build up and build up to something like a 4 or a 5 hits, and then it releases the energy over to the east, and we'll see a new 4.0 or similar sized earthquake strike over to the east at the pumping operations in Oklahoma, Texas, Kansas, and so forth. Now that this new 3.9 struck today, we can certainly expect activity to increase across Texas and Oklahoma again in the next couple days, not even that long. How high should it go? Well, it should be equal to or less than the 3.9 that just struck on the West Coast, which really today was a 4. So whatever strikes on Southern California, something similar should be striking over to the east in the next couple days, or swarm that size. Okay, so let's recap one more time. The West Coast moved mostly at volcanoes. I just proved that to you by looking up each location. The only spots where we have direct fault zone activity is on the creeping section of the San Andreas and the San Jacinto, which is really slow slipping. Now, slow slipping term used by professionals, I've got articles linked down below. Still, it's over a year now that they put the articles out about Southern California building into the potential of an extremely large earthquake. But the extremely large earthquake, they said, will be striking on a nearby fault to the San Jacinto. Well, I mean, a nearby fault would either be the Elsinore or the San Andreas. So, I mean, you could take your pick. You get a large earthquake here, all three are going to feel it, and all three could move. You might not just get one single earthquake. You might get multiple earthquakes as the faults shift. As a matter of fact, that's likely. It's just a matter of those faults being smaller movement. You wouldn't expect the same sized earthquake on all three faults. If that happened, it would be devastating. It would be three different megaquakes, not one. So professionals are leaning towards one different fault here, breaking eventually as it absorbs too much force and it can't pass it off quick enough. Now we're already dealing with an input 6.8 almost four weeks ago. So it's been almost a month now, but not quite. So we put in a 6.8, California started to burn. I don't know. Again, there's some people that think it's a directed energy weapon. So we get back up here and we've got our hot spots going. If we see fires break out now, all I've got to say, even if fires don't break out, with hot spots and earthquakes and pumping operations all right by each other like that, you've got to be willing to at least venture the possibility that it could be related. Now, over here in the West Pacific, this is a definite increase. To go from next to nothing to this, to 6, 5.8 and 5.0. But that's still a magnitude 1.8 magnitude less than what we would expect. Guys, if this was a 6.8, I would consider that an earthquake forecast hit. But because it's a 5.8, of course, we're coming in way less than expected for Indonesia. There was an increase in volcanic eruptions over the past day and a half. Kerangetang, Ibu, Dukono, all three of those going. With a new earthquake striking over in Sumatra, where the arrows point. Guys, I just want you to be on watch still. I told you I was going to watch for a couple more days, and then we get hit with the 6. I hope that's all it is, really. But I want you to be ready. Don't let your guard down just because it goes a couple days beyond the time that I issue the warning for. I try to get it down based upon past experience, 7 to 10 days. That's why I issue the 7 to 10 day watches. It's because within 7 to 10 days of our deep earthquakes, we usually see the shallower, larger earthquakes pop up. And that's not just my take on it. That's me and everyone else who's been watching along with me in earnest, who's been a fair observer. Of course, there's people that, you know, deny everything, but, you know, we can't help that. All right, so do you have an earthquake plan? We're getting to that part of this update. Do you know what to do when an earthquake strikes? If you don't know what to do, I would suggest immediately thinking about what you would do. And if you don't have any clue, you can do some searching. I would recommend taking shelter or getting out of the structure if the earthquake is severe enough. Now, it's ideal to take shelter, because if you're going to try and get out of the structure, you might be running out into a worse situation. However, there's going to be some people who live in stone stack buildings of some kind, you know, brick or cinder block or mortar of some kind. You're going to need to either really be confident in your structure or get out. And if you're going to go out, you need to know which door and where you're going to go once you're outside. Once you're outside, it's winter here in the North America, you know, anywhere from north of Missouri all the way up into Canada. Guys, you get displaced outside, you might be in a bad situation within an hour or two. It was so cold the other day here. I'm telling you, if you were outside for more than a couple hours, it would have been bad news. I could only imagine, somebody who might be a little elderly or maybe a person who's disabled. This is something that we need to plan for now, and we need to take the appropriate steps. If you know people in your life who are disadvantaged or disabled or are not able to take care of these things, you need to look out for them. Make sure that these things are set up for them too. And if you've got kids, grandkids, something else to think about as well, right? So you can take care of your kids, your grandkids, by simply putting together a emergency kit that'll get you through, I would say day one for sure, of course day one, but something that'll get you through just if you get displaced outside for several hours to a day, and you can eventually get back into your structure, or you have a actual full-on emergency plan to get out of your area and have a place to go to. But that gets into long-term prepping, that gets into having a plan and being prepared beyond just day one. Day one is having a kit, knowing what to do when the earthquake hits, and then usually going back to your structure and trying to figure out how you're going to be surviving in that structure that's still there. If the earthquake is severe enough, you're going to need to have a regional plan, someplace to go. I would suggest not waiting for Big Brother. That is the last thing you want to do. They can't even plow the streets right. They can't even get along. So you do not want to wait for them. They'll put you in a best case scenario. They'll put you in a gymnasium or some kind of stadium. with a bunch of other people you don't know. Yeah, that's a great idea. Yeah, or you could have your own campground that you've picked out for $10 a night, pretty cheap, and you can be roasting marshmallows. Make sure to have marshmallows in your emergency kit, of course. But you can be on foot to your place as opposed to on a bus to a locked stadium. Who knows? I don't know what your life situation is, but I'll tell you, Big Brother never can solve it. It is 11:08 p.m. Central Time on the 29th of November, 2018. Do you like what I do? There's a lot of people who do. There's a few people who don't, but we're not worried about trying to get through to them right now. If you want to support my operation, check it out. Dutch Sinse merch. You can get Dutch Sinse merch still. We've got shirts, sweatshirts. This is for the people who are still looking to stay warm with Dutch merch. Awesome stuff, guys. You're incredible. Thank you for supporting my operation. Let's also jump over to YouTube and see how we're doing. All the nice folks over on YouTube. Hey, look, we're doing all right. And I'm trying to grow the number. Hey, we're at 291,226. Well, I'll say we're growing. It definitely has grown. Trying to reach 300,000, then 1 million, then 10 million. I don't know how it's going to happen. I'll just cross my fingers. Hope for the best. Ask Santa Claus. Let's go over to Twitch, see what's going on Twitch. Hi, everyone on Twitch. Everybody here really has put some time and effort in. They've also built a good community. And there's also other great channels to watch on Twitch. If you get tired of doing the earthquake thing, you can now do a split screen, I think, or there's some way to do some kind of split screen. Pretty cool stuff. And everybody over here has put a lot of effort in getting the word out on earthquakes. I know that. Wow. So awesome. Look at all the love here, guys. And thank you for your well wishes. Again, this is, look at all the hearts. That's awesome. All right. And we're done. So you guys, peace out. Be safe. Don't be scared. There's no reason to be scared of earthquakes anymore. They're not random. I just proved to you that in California. They're not random. Same for up in Canada. Pumping operation. Phew, right there. Hot spots right next to it. Oil pumping, not just fracking, not just, well, I mean, oh boy, okay, we could get into fracking, wastewater disposal terminology. I'm just going to tell you, drill points, just watch out at these spots. They're not random. Now that you understand that, that removes the fear. So let me explain it, and then we'll sign off. We know where the force starts. It starts down below the plates at our deep earthquake locations. The force flows out from those deep earthquake locations and spreads out across the planet. As it flows out and across the planet, it drops off earthquakes along the way, similar sized. So we get spreads of fives, spreads of fours, spreads of sixes sometimes, sometimes even spreads of sevens occur. We've seen it happen. Enough that when the spreads begin, we can see at the start of a week, for instance, and by the end of the week, you'll see it ramp up on the other side of the planet. And then it starts over with a cycle. The cycle starts over. It's like the beat of a drum. And then it resonates out again around the planet. Happens over and over again. Multiple times per month, usually. The bigger the disturbance, the bigger the release. Basic physics 101 here. We get a big push, big motion. Where does the push come from? Well, we get into the core of the Earth. That might ruffle a few feathers, I'd say. Hey, a new earthquake just hit. Hold on. New 3.7, striking over in Romania, filling in between our middle points, between South Europe and North Europe. Boom. What a way to finish it. 3.7, halfway fulcrum point, right on our arrow, right on the middle of the S in the middle of Romania. 3.3 on one side, 4.4 on the other. Middle point filled in, just as I'm talking. All right, well, that's a good example. Just something else to watch for, middle points to get filled in. I could just keep talking for hours, but I shouldn't. Shouldn't do that yet. Not fully recovered yet enough to do a two-hour presentation. I'm done. You guys have a good night. I'll be back if anything else goes down. Peace out. Oh, and this will premiere over on YouTube in just a little bit.